Okay.
Can you hear me?
Good.
So, I just wanted to thank you, Gonzalo, for the invitation, but also Glenn for giving me so many keywords, because this will now probably sound like a case study to what you just showed. So basically, first, what is Frontiers? Frontiers is an online publisher for academic material. Our main business is taking papers from universities, getting them to an online peer review system, which we have built, and publishing them online in an open access business model. The second half is we also have a social network. So here comes your first keyword. How do I explain to my mom what I'm doing? Basically, Facebook is for everybody. LinkedIn is for business people. Frontiers will be for scientists. So that's the, well, at the moment I would say it's the plan or the aspiration. We'll see whether we get there. So basically our CEO unfortunately couldn't come, so I have to stand in. You don't have my CV in the paper, so I just say a little bit about myself. I'm the CTO of Frontiers. I'm running the development operations team in currently three locations in our Swiss headquarters. Then we have a partner company in India, and we have a new office here at UPM in Madrid, which is developing very nicely. So the responsibilities are to get my team to architecture and develop the system. Originally that was just me architecting it, but now it's a bigger team. And of course all the support, all the operations which goes with it. I have probably now, well more than 15 years of experience. Started in the times of Unix, Berkeley in 1985. If you now go on a Linux startup system, a micro instance of AWS, it probably is not such a big difference except for the speed of deploying it. Originally I'm a physicist. I did a master in numerical simulation of cosmic rays. So in the end, that was software development. It was physics, it was some formula, but the main part was what we called a loosely coupled multiprocessor system, which is basically having PCs in the office, putting data in floppy disk in there at night, collecting the results the next morning. So that was a loosely coupled multiprocessor system. Okay, so that's about me. Now about Frontiers. As I said, the main thing is an open access publisher and a research network. So it has all the features of Facebook, LinkedIn. Over time it will have all of them. But it also has the publishing content, and we believe that these two things together make sure that there's actually something happening in the network. The same what LinkedIn also did recently, getting feeds of content into their network. But we actually started on the content side and then built the network rather than the other way. It was founded in 2007 by two neuroscientists, really with focus on publishing. A lot of you will have experience in academic publishing. A lot of you will have experienced some pain points in getting your papers accepted. So the main goal of the company was we wanted to make that a nicer, a better experience for the scientist. And we want to make sure that the scientists actually have a role in that whole review process and not just being the victim of rejection or sometimes acceptance. We are headquartered in the EPFL, that's the Technical University in Lausanne, similar to the Technical University in Zurich, which is a little bit more well known since the time of Einstein there. But in recent times, actually, the Lausanne sister is doing pretty well in all kinds of mathematics. Our company has now moved out of the direct startup phase. Actually, we joined the Nature Publishing Group. I'm not sure whether I call it a merger or acquisition, because we are not fully owned by them, but it's basically they take a large equity stake in our company. As a result of that, we could accelerate our technology development, and part of that was also opening a software center here at UPM. That's just how it looks like when on the 140-year-old Nature magazine there is a flyer, full-page advert about frontiers. It was the first time in 140 years that they made this flip-open cover, and they promised us to never do it again for the next 140 years. So what we are now is we have 35 journals in 19 academic disciplines with about 250 specialty sections. You see the numbers. Basically, we are big, but we are not Facebook. We are not nowhere near the very big sites. But with our growth, actually the company is growing nice. And these articles earn real money. So it's not that we are a startup which is just burning in the hope of future. We are in a time where we are, at the moment, investing more than we earn. But we could scale our investment and our ramp up just to the cost basis if we want. So that's basically the list of the journals we have. I do have finals here, but I won't go into that. So basically, the one side of this, the left side, is the publishing side. When the paper gets accepted, it is Creative Commons open license. On the right-hand side, you see basically the components of the social network. But we are talking here about the building the business, not what it's doing. That should just be giving you an idea what we are doing. I think I skipped a little bit the slides about the business, and so directly. So that is how our social network looks. For my feeling, it looks a little bit overcrowded. We are addressing that, but it has most of the components that you expect in a social network. But it has also feeds from our publishing system. If an article gets published, then in the author's feed it will be pushed here as a news to the public. So that is some of the key challenges we have. Basically, our business model or our expectation is that the open access publishing plus the social networking cross-fertilize each other. You get a higher exposure to the scientists via the network and merging the published articles in there, but you also get the way back. More people read the articles if they come via the author's profile to the articles. So we believe that this gives opportunity to both the author in disseminating his published works to a wider audience, but also discussion opportunities and all the features of the program. So now, we had a discussion about, Torsten, you mentioned that not-for-profit company, evil versus a good one. We didn't take it from a moral point of view, or maybe actually initially we did, but that was before my time. So anyway, we started as a not-for-profit. We soon realized that in order to run this whole show of a worldwide publishing. You need to have servers, you need to have developers, you need to have money and funding, and you need to build a business around it. So very soon we got change our plan. That was probably a pivot moment to move from this not-for-profit to a for-profit. We found investors. One of them was actually really playing the role of angel investor, who injected also the business knowledge into our company, not just the money, but if I just think the shareholder meetings with him were to me, they were training sessions. We had a small group of existing shareholders at that time, but basically that was the start of Frontier as a company. We started to build a prototype website which was showing our publishing model, but it did not address all the plans of scaling to hundreds of journals. It was just a very prove the business model first. In the end, we proved that that we got a market, that the market exists, and that people pay for the service. We got another round of investment funding. We threw away the prototype and replaced it with a stronger build system, which really was addressing scalability and extendability, maintenance, and so on. With that, over the time, we actually went cash positive. So we went out of the startup phase for the first time. But then we also attracted Nature Publishing Group as one of the most distinguished publishers in the world, 140 years of history. They got attracted to us. They also tried to do this business model of innovating by mergers and acquisitions, which you also mentioned. And they do buy a couple of smaller companies. Now for them, we are actually quite big at that time. So they are usually buying companies of 1, 2, 3 people. We were 20, 30 at that time. But we linked up with them, and that allowed us to ramp up faster. But we are still in control of what we do and how we do things. It's still the role of an investor rather than a real market. After that, we wanted to extend our IT organization, our software development team, we looked at that great opportunity which came up here in Madrid. We actually had long-term relationships to this university already from the beginning of our company, more on the scientist side. Some of our chief editors were here from the university, so there was some relationship. But then we jumped here, we set up a team. They are working now on a project together with our team in Switzerland to extend the system from 100,000 users to hopefully 5 million. Let's see. And at the same time, over the 3-4 years, some of our technology is no longer up to date, and we need to accelerate our technology adoption. So that's what we are hoping to get out here from the team concerned. Now, that is the company now. I told you that beginning of the year it was 20. Now this is a little bit more. But what I also wanted to show you is basically that we put a few little flags to each of these persons. And it starts from the top, the two founders. The company is in Switzerland. The two founders have together 4 passports. None of them is Swiss. So together with the residency, that makes 5 countries. And that basically set a role model for the company, whether you intentionally do it or whether it just happens. So it turns out that a lot of people here have 1 or 2 passports, or they are different countries, wherever they come from. So we learned diversity is good. It helps you getting influence ideas in the company. So we didn't look at that same thing when we opened the team here in Spain. We just looked for people who we could communicate with, and it just so happens that the first eight people we have here have already four nationalities again. So, okay. Just wanted to say diversity helps, especially if your market is global, but it's also a lot of fun. You should try to get there if you have a chance. Now, quickly, what have we seen? What have we got in incubator facilities? One thing was mentioned, it has helped us tremendously in grow our space. We started with two people, we moved to 10, to 20, to 40, to 80 people. Each time we had to move our offices around, but each time that move was less than 100 meters. And that makes it so much easier to grow the company, because as a small company, you don't have the time to hire a facilities manager, get a truck, get all these stuff organized. So the easier that is, and if all of that is still with the same landlord, again, it's much easier. You just say, I need a bigger office in 3 months, in 2 months, can we do it? So that is one of the big benefits, flexibility in size. Then, of course, we have benefited a lot from networking with other companies. There are courses on the campus about how to build a startup, how to do marketing. Some of that applied to us, some of that didn't, but in general it was a very good thing to have, and it was very good to have also the surrounding of other people, just from a feeling. You talk to similar people. Then of course, having all these worries not on your desk, like telecom, internet connection, parking spaces, conference rooms, you don't want all of that at the startup. You want to simplify that. So, for me, our lessons learned are you need to address your biggest risk first in the startup. And for me, the biggest risk is, will your product or your service actually have a market? The sooner you find that, the better you are. And that's why we built a prototype site. We brought it out, we scrapped it when it did its job. Get investors who also can inject business knowledge, unless you have it yourself. If you have done three startups, you don't need it. But on your first startup, get people on your supervisory board as investors who can inject that knowledge. Also, incubator spaces serve the same purpose. You get a lot of marketing, sales information. It just helps. Again, diversity is good. And the last thing that is CTO, of course, I'm really thrilled to see all the cloud economy taking off, because in my last company, getting a new development server was an action of 6 weeks, and that company was selling servers for $10 billion a year. Still getting a server in your own data center took 6 weeks. Now it takes less than an hour. So, and you can get it for a day or two. So use it wherever you can. The smaller you are, the more.